anything, we've learned that we always have to adapt and change around here. It's not COVID, it's the weather. So welcome to this first Sunday in Lent, and also to a little bit of Ash Wednesday thrown into the mix. Because we moved our Ash Wednesday service, we canceled on Wednesday because of the snowstorm. So we're folding a little bit of it into our worship today. Maybe some of you are not accustomed to coming to Ash Wednesday services. Some of you are. But what we're going to do at the beginning of this time together is we'll use this rite with the ashes, R-I-T-E, this ritual with the ashes, to mark our entry into the season of Lent. So what we'll do is I will offer an opening, some opening words. We will take some time in silent prayer. I will bless the ashes which are up here on the altar. And while we're singing, the choir will lead us in singing, and I invite anyone who would want to make your way up to the rail to receive the imposition of ashes on your forehead. So that's how we'll begin our service, and then we'll move into our service for First Lent. So again, welcome. I invite you to stand as you're able. Dear people of God, the first Christians observed with great devotion the days of our Lord's passion and resurrection, and it became the custom of the church to prepare for them by a season of penitence and fasting. This season of Lent provided a time in which converts to the faith were prepared for holy baptism. It was also a time when those who, because of notorious sins, had been separated from the body of the faithful were reconciled by penitence and forgiveness and restored to the fellowship of the church. Thereby, the whole congregation was put in mind of the message of pardon and absolution set forth in the gospel of our Savior, and of the need which all Christians continually have to renew their repentance and faith. I invite you, therefore, in the name of the church, to the observance of a holy Lent. By self-examination and repentance, by prayer, fasting, and self-denial, and by reading and meditating on God's holy word. And to make a right beginning of repentance, and as a mark of our mortal nature, let us now kneel before the Lord, our Maker and Redeemer. Bless the Lord who forgives all our sins. Almighty God,
to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
God, whose blessed Son was led by the Spirit to be tempted by Satan, come quickly to help us who are assaulted by many temptations. And as you know the weaknesses of each of us, let each one find you mighty to save. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Serpent was more crafty than the other wild animal that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God say you shall not eat of any, from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the middle of the garden, nor shall you touch it, or you shall die." But the serpent said to the woman, "You will not die. God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate it. She also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. They sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves. The word of the Lord.
Thanks
be to God.
Thank you.
sin came into the world through one man, and death came through sin. So death spread to all because all had sinned. Sin was indeed in the world before the law, but sin is not reckoned when there is no law. Yet death exercised dominion from Adam to Moses, even over those whose sins were not like the transgression of Adam, who is the type of the one who is to come. But the free gift is not like the trespass. For if the many died through the one man's trespass, much more surely have the grace of God and the free gift of the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for the many. And the free gift is not like the effect of the one man's sin. For the judgment following one trespass brought condemnation, but the free gift following many trespasses brought justification. If because of the one man's trespasses, death exercised dominion through that one, much more surely will those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness exercise dominion in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Therefore, just as the one man's trespasses led to the condemnation of all, no one man's act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all. For just as by the one man's disobedience the many were made sinners, so by the one man's obedience the many will be made righteous. The word of the Lord.
He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "Again, it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. And he said to him, "All these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Two of our members of this congregation, Ann Sarda and Marilyn Clark, are part of the Lay Preaching Initiative, doing a two-year training on preaching, learning to become, being equipped to be preachers. Part of that conversation is engaging the congregation in scripture and reflection on scripture and the preaching. With that in mind, Ann Sarda and Scott Clark have are hosting our community forums where they're engaging all of us and reflecting on scripture and the sermon after the service. So I hope that as many of you as can stay will do that. They're going to take us through questions of reflection. And I'm giving this heads up so that you just don't go to sleep right now. that actually you are ready for the test downstairs. And actually, I say that in jest, this is really about conversation. Because what is a sermon? A sermon is a person's conversation with scripture, with one's own life, with the what happened that week, what's in the news. This is my, as I offer some words to you this morning, what I'm really doing is just kind of continuing the conversation, offering my voice to this conversation, inviting your voice into the conversation. So I just want you to listen and talk with me in your minds now. You're totally welcome to shout something out as well. But especially continue the conversation downstairs, because this word of scripture that we engage with every week comes alive as we talk with it. And so with fear and trembling, I offer you my part of the conversation. God put them in the Garden of Eden to till it and to keep it. I have great parents. My mother is no longer living, but I have a sense of having grown up as a fortunate person with parents who loved me and tended me and taught me, I think, really some of the basic stuff about they believed in me and loved me and made me feel worthy for the most part. I will say I can go back, as any child of parents can go back, and blame parents for this and that. And I will tell you, one of my worst memories as a child was when my parents decided that it was a good idea to take the four children to go see a horror movie. I lost my innocence. Do you remember anyone who's seen a horror movie knows that it's usually like the babysitter who's in charge and that door should not be opened because you know that something really bad is happening and it's going to be on the other side of that door. And the music helps you feel it and you just know exactly what the outcome is going to be, but you can't stop looking or you close your eyes kind of in fear. That's the image, or that's the sense, the feeling I have as I engage with the scripture today from the book of Genesis and from our gospel reading from Matthew. First, from Genesis, we've got this story that many of us have in deep in our bones about Adam and Eve in the garden. And God saying, you may eat of every tree, but the tree of knowledge of evil and good, no, off limits. And enter that character, I think the evil characters are often the most interesting in any plot line. Enter the crafty serpent, the crafty serpent. Why not eat of that? If you do, you will be like God. And we already know that they're going to make the wrong decision and eat of that fruit. Similarly, and by contrast, the other story of temptation from the Gospel of Matthew We have Jesus who is led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And we already know who the hero is going to be. I mean, here's this satanic figure saying, if you do this, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. And he said to them, all these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me. And we know the hero will say, away with you, Satan. For it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him. Especially in Genesis, I want to dive in a little bit about this plot twist. From goodness, this tempted by Satan, this plot twist from this idyllic Garden of Eden, taking that bite, this story has become so much enmeshed in our psyche, this original sin, the fall, this notion of this thing that happened in the storyline that's connected to each of us, that somehow leads to the exposure of these two humans and their shame and their separation. But I want to pan out for a little bit, to use the movie image, to look at the larger picture of this from the story of Genesis. Because this comes in Genesis 2, chapter 2, whereas in the first chapter of Genesis, we know another part of the context of this. In the beginning, when God created, was a formless void, and the wind swept over the waters, and God said, let there be light, and there was light, and God saw that the light was good. And in Genesis 2, we have kind of the second story of creation. The first story is one rendition of how humans came about. In Genesis 2, we hear, then the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And the man became a living being, and the Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east, and there he put the man whom he had formed. The Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. Then the Lord God took the people and put them in the Garden of Eden to till it and to keep it. The very foundation of this story, the backstory, God created from the dust. God saw that it was good. God took the earth and formed God's first humans, Adam, meaning human, and place them in a garden with a purpose, to care for the garden, to tend it, to sustain it. As God's beloved, these beloved, God put them in the Garden of Eden to till it and to keep it. From the earth, bodies from the soil, hands to tend the soil. It just feels so poignant that here we are celebrating Ash Wednesday, marking Ash Wednesday. We are physically connected. Remember that you are dust, and to dust you shall return. With ashes on our foreheads, entering the season of Lent to make a new beginning. The question I ask for the season of Lent is, how do I cultivate in this garden? What does it look like to be with God's other, my companions that God has created, to be the beloved, to be connected to God, to you, to this earth, to be in relationship, each of us, to till and to keep this earth? Tilling and keeping the earth. neighbor, Clem, who Clem always felt like an old man. When my children were little, he was one of those people who was retired, but he just felt ancient. He was one of these people who was like known on the block to always be walking about, greeting people. He knew all the names of the neighbors and the names of the children. He didn't have any children himself, but when he saw that people were moving, that traffic was moving too quickly down our street, he was the one who put up in front of his house the sign that said, "Please drive slowly, there are children who live here." Clem was a runner and a walker. Whenever he would run, he would carry a little bag, and he would pick up trash and put it in the bag. When he, as a walker, he would organize neighbors to go walk together, because our neighborhood can be a little dangerous sometimes, and it was good to have a presence of people walking the streets. When I think of humility, something we talk about in Lent, when I think about humility, I think about Clem. Humility from the word humus, close to the earth, close to the earth. In relationship to the earth, to one another, to the neighborhood, to the children. And when Clem got cancer and was dying, he invited neighbors to come and see him. And I went to see him, and it was as if he was offering a blessing to me. It's really kind of powerful to me to think that the people after Clem died, the people who bought his house, are the ones who this week plowed the sidewalk along the whole street with their snowblower. Something that was Clem tilling and keeping the soil of our neighborhood, somehow it just feels like it was passed down to the people in that house, helping to till and to keep, to continue to do so. God put them in the garden to till it and to keep it. How are we tillers and keepers of our gardens? So yes, Lent, here we are. I'm asking the question, how do we till and keep this garden? And I will tell you that at St. David's, we're really good at coming out with a program guide with how to do these things. Before you leave today, and I jest a little bit, but we do have this invitation to Lent to engage deeply in the season, and we have various practices, Lenten practices, that we want to invite you into. And this is good. This is good. This is like, how do we create this kind of trellis of faith so that we can hold on to our relationships with God, ourselves, with one another. And yet, there's a temptation here, as there always is a temptation. That in my anxiety about not getting it right, in my anxiety about being a good person, wanting to do good stuff in the world, that if only I adopt a program, it's gonna work. It's embedded in us, too, that somehow we have to strive to produce, to eat of that fruit that says, I can do more, I can get it right. The writer Tara Brach talks about this anxiety in our culture that is a temptation and a false god, I would say. We believe we must strive tirelessly, working, acquiring, achieving, emailing, overcommitting, and rushing in a never-ending quest to prove ourselves once and for all. This is our dilemma. We want to be in right relationship. How do we do it? Can I only rely on myself if I do more? Somehow, I will be restored into right relationship in this Garden of Eden. Mother Teresa said, The biggest disease today is not leprosy or tuberculosis, but rather the feeling of not belonging. And I would say of not being the beloved in relationship with God and one another. So during this season of Lent, by each of us to till and to tend this life that we've been given, which is our own kind of storyline, our movie, as it were, this life that we're living. How do we focus on tending and tilling, not disregarding the reality of temptation by looking toward our belovedness and relationship? We know that that sin is real, that separation is real. If we think about the soil, I just think about this very church, that the land that this church sits on was held by native peoples. I mean, this goes deep. I think about the soil that we live on, that has across the globe tremors of earthquakes that continue. Our connection to the soil is complicated. How we tread on this earth, how we come from the earth, and how we return to the earth is so much about our connection with one another and with God, and in some ways beyond our power and control. We started our service by singing the Kyrie Eleison, which translated is, Lord have mercy, Christ have mercy, Lord have mercy. In the season of Lent, we do long to be in connection with God, with one another, with ourselves. We know we cannot do it alone. It is only Christ and God that we can say, Lord have mercy, Christ have mercy, Lord have mercy, as we till and tend this precious earth and these precious lives. Amen.
One God, Father.
have eyes to see the suffering of others, both close to home and throughout the world. God of mercy, we pray that we might experience your presence when we claim new definitions of identity. Grant us comfort and peace as we understand ourselves anew, and may each of us be accepted as beautiful expressions of God's love.
Be always with you. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us an offering and sacrifice to God. Thank you. By his grace, we are able to triumph over every evil and to live no longer for ourselves alone, but for him who died for us and rose again. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Thank you.
Pam are taking communion to George Willard this morning. In the name of this congregation, I send you forth, bearing these holy gifts, that those to whom you go may share with us in the communion of Christ's body and blood.
We who are many are one body, because we share one bread and the one cup.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do your work you've given us to do, to love and serve. Art, and she made this available for us to use, and I actually it makes me think of Lent and the path of Lent, and but a lot of her work is abstract. You'll see, in this program guide, you'll see a link to her art, and this her art is all throughout this too. So we just have so many gifts and talents here, and just grateful for her willingness to let us use some of her art. I do want to say a word to you. Please do take this program guide. I think there's one thing in particular I want to draw your eye to, and that is the invitation to create what we call a rule of life. Like, how do we pattern our lives? And how do we, take stock of how we spend our time? And so we are inviting people to think seriously about what the hours of our days look like, and how we can perhaps more intentionally think about how we want to pattern our life with one another, with God, through prayer, nature, etc. And as a way to kind of get into that, throughout the season of Lent, we're going to hear kind of testimonials from some of you about your own rule of life. So next week we'll have our first. We don't have all the Sundays filled up with speakers yet, so if you have some stories about the way you pattern your life in prayer and intentional kind of Christian life, I invite you to let me know and we'll get you scheduled to speak. And it's really important that we hear from one another on this. The last announcement that I want to make is I just want to say yay to St. David's for sending 5 people to the Community of Hope Lay Pastoral School training that started this weekend. We're part of the Episcopal Church of Minnesota Community of Hope training. I've been one of the organizers of it. And we had 18 people from across the diocese, and 5 of those were from St. David's. Yesterday we spent a whole day doing good work together, so just know that we have a great contingent from here that you'll be hearing from more later. Anna, or Diane, or whoever's next.
Good morning. Diane Kerr will be here. Wanted to bring 2 things to your attention, and in keeping with the sermon theme about tilling the garden, we've got great opportunities to till the garden because you need soil, which I consider us corporately and separately, and we need tools. And so we're offering some tools on Wednesday nights from 5:30 to 6:15. We're going to have What Is God Up To theme for the Lenten series, and then from 6:15 to 7. 5:30 to 6:15 is the food. I'm getting this. First come for the food, which is great, potluck or what have you, and then from 6:15 to 7 is the programming. So we really encourage you to come. It's a way of rule of life, maybe, to get involved with Lent, and it's a time for conversation, sharing, and tilling the soil. So I think you will enjoy it. And then lastly, it's 4 nights, but there's 5 Wednesdays in Lent, and guess what the middle of Wednesday is? It's St. Patty's Day. So we're going to have the St. Patrick's Day dinner. It's been 3 years since we've had it. It's kind of a tradition here if you're new to church. And we have great cooks. Sarah Lee and Dean Sather make this wonderful traditional St. Patrick's Day dinner. But we need numbers because it's pricey and they need to figure out how much to buy. So there's this sign up in the back downstairs, or we actually went online too. So you can use that. I don't know. Wednesday's not hot luck, but I don't know what man's got brewing. But it's good food, trust me. Somebody's cooking. You don't have to cook as a bad one. Yeah. Just show up. Just show up.
I am Roger Stratton, Minister of Music. And this is a musically rich season. Many thanks to our choir today. Several opportunities coming up. One is during the community dinners, at 6:30, while the bells are up, belling up here, and the youth group is off youth grouping somewhere, any children are invited into the music group to play around with music from about 6:30 to 6:50, something like that. And we'll get out the orphan instruments. If you don't know what that is, all the more reason to come. And we'll have a good time. Then also on March 11th, we'll have a concert here by the University of Minnesota at Morris Choir. They came last year, and people love the concert. That's a Saturday evening, March 11th at 7. And then the following Wednesday, March 15th, we're going to start practicing for Easter. So just like at Christmas, we have people join us, singing, playing instruments, whatever. If you're interested in any of that, please let me know. And we will start playing around with Easter music on March 15th. Thank you.
Good morning, my name is Ann Sara, and I'm one of the lay trainers in preaching, and I'm here to invite you to come down from the forum, and thank you to Catherine for introducing it so beautifully. It's meant to be enriching both to the preacher and to us as listeners, but I just want to invite you to bring your bulletins down if you want to have the scripture passages to be able to reference, so remember to bring your bulletin.
Also on March 11th, on Saturday morning, from 9 to 11:30, we have two facilitators coming to St. David's to conduct a men's retreat. And these two fellows, Peter Watkins and Samuel Rayburn, have a lot of experience in doing this. And we're really excited about it. And we'd love to have as many men in the parish as possible sign up for it. We'll be meeting in the narthex. And if you could just notify either Anna in the office or me that you're planning on coming, that would be great, because we are going to have at least something to eat in the morning, and then we're planning on having a lunch as well. So we've already got a good starting group. Please sign up.
Good morning. My name is Anna. I'm the children and youth minister here. And I have a couple exciting things that we're going to be starting off with Lent. First of all, we have confirmation today. That'll be after the forum at 11:45, and we'll order some pizza as we normally do. It's our fourth session out of four. So awesome job to those students who have been committed to that class series. We have our liturgy reflections, confirmation students. Turn those in. There's a spot by my office door for you to turn those in. You're not going to be graded, but we do want to collect them. And then as far as this Wednesday for youth group, we are going to be headed back to Global Health Ministries Warehouse to do some volunteer work there. So we'll meet here in the carpool. We'll leave at 5:30 so that we can get to Fridley in time for our volunteer session, and I believe that's just going to be our group again, just like it was last time we went, if you came last time. So join us, and confirmation students, please join us, because that is a big part of your community service exploration as part of confirmation. And then, for growing a rule of life, I love how all the themes came together, and I wasn't here for the sermon, but I'm excited that you talked about dirt. Because as you'll see, when we head out of worship today in the narthex, you'll get a chance, every single one of us will get a chance to help in burying a special word that I'm not allowed to say. We put this word away during Lent, and in children's time last week, we talked about how putting something away for a while and then bringing it back out again can make it all that more special. And then children and their families, and I invite anybody else who wants to engage in this practice, if you're thinking about how do I engage in a rule of life, the children are going to be taking home a little plant today. And it's a special plant, because these plants are found in the wilderness, in the desert, and they don't take much to survive. And so each of the children picked out a plant in Godly Play today. And so they need to come down to the Godly Playroom and take that home. And they also have these handouts, Growing Rule of Life Worksheet, and the Faith 5. So make sure to grab those. And so that's meant for your family to come together at least once a week. Give your plant a little bit of water. And your plant just needs water once a week. Okay? Just once a week. And come together and engage in a faith practice. We also have these Be Still prayer cards to grab as well. And then for the whole parish, we have these cards that are a word a day. And so we have some that are pre-cut and ready for you to just grab and go, but we have some that have yet to be assembled. So those are just back here by the table under the And so please, as we're leaving worship, make sure to grab a shovel full of dirt and help us bury the
Please stand as for the dismissal.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.